We're recovering from a hangover of about a decade associated with Afghanistan and Iraq. For the last 10 years, Western militaries have been engaged in really adapting to a fiendishly difficult challenge, which is how do you find, fix, and finish a very lightly equipped, low contrast, fast moving, non-state enemy in incredibly remote, rugged, predominantly rural terrain. And we've got very, very good at that. Particularly special operations, time sensitive targeting methodology that was developed in Iraq, a lot of the new ISR capability, the way that we operate to integrate civil and military intelligence capabilities on the ground has just dramatically moved on. And we've got, I think, very good at that. But there's a couple of things about the way we've been operating which I think we should be cognizant of as we think about the future. And one of them is the very fact that we've been doing primarily operations in landlocked rural environments. Now, the only military that served in Iraq or Afghanistan with any experience in urban littoral is the British Army in Basra and in the Fal Peninsula during the invasion of Iraq. The American military engaged in a very substantial amount of urban combat in Iraq, but it was all in a landlocked AOR in the middle of Iraq. The Americans have done one major littoral insertion, which was General Mattis's raid to capture Fob Rhino in 2002, and that was unopposed. So really, there's a bit of experience in the British Army, but predominantly the new normal for most of NATO, for most of the 50 countries that were in Iraq and the 51 that are in Afghanistan, has been this rural, mountainous, landlocked environment against non-state adversaries. But if you look at the future operating environment, that's not the environment that we're likely to be in. And the four trends that Charlie mentioned are driving a very significant environmental shift. Population growth, 750 million people on the planet at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, 1.5 billion in 1900, 3 billion in 1960, 6 billion in 2000, 7 billion now. There's this accelerating population growth that isn't uniformly spread across the planet. It's very heavily focused in urban environments. In that same time frame, we've gone from 2% to 25% to 50% urbanization on the planet. We're tracking for 60 to 70% urbanization by the middle of the century. The entire west coast of India will be one single giant conurbation, according to the Indian Institute for Human Settlement. Cities like Dhaka, which was 400,000 people, about the same size as Canberra, or a little bit bigger than Brighton in 1950, is 12 million today. We're seeing not only population growth and urbanization, we're seeing this coastal tendency, which frankly, in systems terms, is what I would call sensitivity to initial conditions, right? There's no necessary reason why large cities have to be on coastlines. It just so happens that people flock to existing cities and the world is already very littoral. 80% of the world's population lives within 50 miles of a coastline. So as people move to existing cities, they're moving to coastal cities, and you see this increasing tendency for populations to cluster in urban environments on coastlines. This is entirely or predominantly a developing world phenomenon. So the guys who do population and urbanization predictions at the UN project 1.2 billion new people in coastal cities in Asia by 2050, 0.8 billion in Africa, and the rest of the sort of 3 billion new urban dwellers scattered around the Caribbean and Latin America. So putting that in perspective, third world coastal cities are going to be hit with a human tsunami that's about the same size, 3 billion, as it took all of human history across the entire planet to generate right up until 1960. And that's all going to happen in the next generation. So the thesis of the book is that's probably going to have some effect on conflict. And the environment in which we operate will be shaped by the fact that wars don't happen randomly. They happen where people live, and increasingly the population of the planet is urban and coastal. The Australian Army published a doctrine called Military Operations in the Littoral Environment in 2000. British Army did a lot of work on urban littorals in the 1990s. So did the Royal Navy. General Victor Krulak, US Marine Corps guy, talked about urban littorals and the Three Block War in 1996. This stuff is not new. It's old. This is what we were doing before we got dragged up into the mountains to fight the Taliban after 2001. But as we come back and we re-engage with stuff that we already understood, there's actually a very important new factor that didn't exist when we were looking at this in the 1990s that fundamentally transforms the face of conflict, and that's connectivity. So when we were writing about these things in the 1990s, that was the pre-cell phone era. It was before there was any significant internet penetration in the third world. It was before satellite television had spread. Now, if you go to Mogadishu or Tripoli or Lagos, as I did for the book, and you walk around, every second person has a cell phone. There are satellite dishes on most buildings. People that move to these cities, in many cases, move there because that's where you go to get connectivity, because you need to be tapped into the global economy in order to generate a livelihood. So there's this very, very different physical environment out there that's driven by connectivity. A couple of examples of that. In 2000, there were 30,000 cell phones in Nigeria. Today, there's 113 million cell phones in Nigeria. In the same time frame, internet access in Nigeria has gone up 51,000%. China and India have both gone up about 3,000% in terms of internet access in the same time frame. 24% of Somalis have and use a cell phone. I walked around Mogadishu, and one of the things that I really found interesting was the Bakara market, which is still a bit of a Mad Max Thunderdome kind of hellhole, which is where the Battle of the Black Sea, or what some people call Black Hawk Down, happened in 1993. In the middle of that market, there's a currency trading floor where the Somali shilling gets traded amongst a bunch of Hawala traders. And this is a currency that survived for 25 years with no state and no central bank. But the way that it works is it floats freely on international exchange rates. And the guys who trade on the floor understand those rates because they're online. And then when they update the currency, which they do five times a day, they send out a burst SMS text message to all the traders in the city who get an update five times a day of what the current value of the currency is. They need to do that because Somalis are fundamentally traders and they're plugged into a global trading network. A million Somalis in the global diaspora, that's 10% of the total Somali population on the planet. That's more normal than you would think now. Sounds kind of weird, but that's how it works in Lagos. It's how it works in Benin City. It's how it works in Tripoli, which is a very interesting place to go out at night. Same kinds of things are happening. And of course, these are all coastal cities, but they're very, very connected now in a way that they've not been before. So let's get military on this set of problems. What we're dealing with here is littoral warfare, which is not coasts and beaches. It's the area of space within which the operational effects of land, sea, aerospace, and cyberspace intersect. But it's actually driven primarily by weapon systems. So you could think about the littoral space as being that area of sea space that you can hit with land-based weapon systems, that area of land that you can hit with sea-based systems, and the aerospace above and around that, and the cyberspace. When you really look at it, though, it's not just that. It's really a nine-domain challenge. On land, you've got a subterranean dimension, sewers, basements, tunnel systems, riverine canals, and so on. You've got the land surface, and you have super surface structures, high-rise buildings, rooftops, that kind of stuff. So already you're looking at a very complicated 360-degree challenge of urban operations on land. At sea, you've got seabed, undersea, sea surface, and maritime aerospace domains that all intersect. You've got some extraordinarily complex coastal hydrography as soon as you get into an urbanized environment. As soon as you begin to think about amphibious or logistics across the shore or seizing a sea point of entry in an urban environment, you have industrial facilities, you've got significant amounts of shipping traffic, you've got industrial chemicals that can have the same effect as a weapon of mass destruction if not correctly handled. There's all sorts of things like undersea cables that can be damaged. It's just a dramatically complex environment. And then you have the cyberspace and the aerospace angle also. What I've suggested in the book is that we need to rethink a lot of what we think we know about things like sea basing, amphibious operations, particularly logistics, expeditionary logistics. The tactics of this stuff, I think, are reasonably well understood. The logistics are really where the challenge lies. So in the United States, there's a doctrine called sea basing, which is essentially about bringing a selective offload logistics platform, so a supply ship that can, like an active warehouse, can extract certain pieces from the hull without having to unpack the entire ship, to about 10 nautical miles offshore, and then running operations for about 10 days. And with the platforms currently existing in the American military, that's about the limit. You can do about 10 days from about 10 nautical miles. Anything beyond that, you really have to come in and seize the sea point of entry. We're not actually talking about classic amphibious here. We're not talking about beach exits and landing on the shore. The Americans have talked for a long time about operational maneuver from the sea, which for them means stepping past the shoreline to find a lodgement area from which you can begin to maneuver against an objective directly. So instead of going through the classical stages of advanced force operations, landing, build up, expansion that we expect in an amphibious operation, the idea is to jump over several stages by seizing a lodgement area inshore. That works well when there's areas of open space that you can go to and establish a build up. Doesn't work very well when you're dealing with one giant conurbation, most of which is shanty towns and informal settlements, you know, slums that fill in the spaces between cities. It also doesn't work very well if you want to stay there for more than a few days. Then you get into much more of a traditional expeditionary logistics model where you're running platforms in and out of a sea point of entry, and you have to secure that point of entry, and you've got to work with the local community and deal with a very complex traffic pattern and set of activities that happen within the city that you're engaging in. So it's not going to be classical amphib. It's going to be a lot more like what we did in Sierra Leone or East Timor, but it could be in much larger cities with much more complex threats. One of the examples I look at in the book is the Mumbai raid of November 2008, which I think most people think they know very well. But most accounts of Mumbai that I've read, and certainly the ones that I saw when I was in the government when it happened, essentially started the story from when the terrorists landed in Colaba. And what they did once they landed was interesting, but what was really interesting was how they got there and the way that they understood the urban flow of Mumbai through about a year's worth of reconnaissance before the attack, but understood the shipping traffic patterns between Mumbai and Karachi, and understood the coastal movement and signature of things like illicit smuggling networks, illicit immigration networks, and the way that fishing and cargo traffic worked. So the terrorists left Karachi in one ship, blended into the coastal shipping traffic of what is Pakistan's largest port. It accounts for 40% of Pakistani trade by volume. In the middle of the night, they hijacked an Indian fishing fleet well out to sea within the middle of the Indian trawler fleet, took the crew away. The captain almost certainly believed that they were smugglers, not terrorists. He let them on board voluntarily. They had him navigate to about 4 nautical miles offshore of Mumbai. They cross-decked into Zodiacs in the middle of the night in Sea State 2, out of sight of land, which, if you've never done it, is difficult and requires a lot of training and practice. They landed in an area that was essentially a slum settlement in the Colaba Peninsula in southern Mumbai, which, if you've been to Mumbai, it's rather odd, because you've got a very typical pattern that we see in a lot of these developing coastal cities, where there's an intermixture of informal slum settlements with business districts, hotels, major infrastructure. So Colaba has these little old fishing villages that were there before the rest of the city was there, that are now little slums, which the police don't go into, and there's not a lot of visibility into from security services. And these guys landed a couple of hundred meters from the target in an area that may as well have been on the moon as far as the police were concerned, because they never went in there. They were soft compromised on landing, so people in the area detected them as they landed. They didn't get ashore secretly, but everybody who saw them thought that they were either smugglers or people coming in as illegal immigrants. No one sort of twigged this is a terrorist attack. They had understood the way that the city flowed as a system, and so they fed into the transportation system. They didn't run up the beach shooting. They hailed taxis and drove off to where they wanted to go. They knew how the city's flow worked. They attacked the main platform of the main railway station at rush hour in a precisely calculated way to shut the city down and draw off the Indian first responders against that attack. And once that attack was fully developed, and they, through a lucky shot, managed to kill the head of the Indian anti-terrorism police, then the main three groups went through to the main targets, which were two luxury hotels and a Jewish center. And they held those targets for about 100 hours, coincidentally the same as what just happened in Nairobi. The technique that they adopted is something I call guerrilla terrorism, and it was first really pioneered in the 7/7 attacks here in London. If you think about 9/11, it was expeditionary terrorism. Al-Qaeda grew the team in Europe and then smuggled 19 people into the United States to do the attack. In the case of the 7/7 bombers, they smuggled one guy out, not 19 people in. They brought Mohammed Siddiqui Khan out of the US, out of the UK to Pakistan for training. Then he came back and grew the team close to the target, inside the firewall, if you like, of border protection and policing. So that was an adaptation to what we had done between 9/11 and 2005 in improving border security. Where it's gone to since then is people have taken that guerrilla approach and gone to the urban siege model, where instead of going in and setting off a bomb, which takes a couple of seconds to explode and then you've got a few hours of media coverage, you seize a major complex piece of urban terrain, you hold it, you fortify it, you defend it, and you either die in place or if you can, you move to another location and continue a running fight. And that has played out in a number of attacks, including most recently Nairobi, but probably the piece de resistance of that technique was the Mumbai attack. How do we do counterterrorism operations in a littoral, crowded, urbanized environment? What you see in Rio, what you see in Lagos, what you see in Mumbai gives you some examples of how we might want to do that. But in a connected environment, there's a whole other set of issues that come into play. So in the case of the Mumbai attack, Lashkar-e-Taiba ran the attack from a safe house in Karachi. They had ISI and Pakistani Special Forces people in the room, and their command and control network was Twitter. So what they did was they had guys watching international news and watching Twitter feeds and blog posts, and they used that as a feedback loop to understand what the Indians were doing. So when the Indian commandos began their assault on the Jewish center, people started tweeting about that. That made it back to the control room, who immediately called their guys in that house and said, defend the roof. When the group took the Taj Mahal Hotel, a lot of people fled to an area that some people may know called the Chambers, which is kind of a club area within the hotel, and began tweeting and calling their relatives to say where they were. That went on to Twitter. The control room picked it up, and they directed a team to go down into that area and find the guys that were hiding in that location. So you've got this complete closed loop driven by Twitter feeds, blogs, news. The Indian Interior Minister came on television and said, don't worry, everybody. The maritime commanders are en route. They'll be at the target in 4 hours. 30 seconds later, the control room tells the guys in the Taj Mahal, you've got 4 hours to harden your position. Start putting barricades in the corridors. And that took another 48 hours to clear. The initial people who confronted the terrorists in Mumbai were all police. It took about 4 hours for any military to hit the scene. So let me finish with a couple of non-military observations. I think we have to start moving away from some of these ideas that have been very popular in the last decade around stabilization. So we talk about stabilization theory, stability operations. The IMF issues stabilization loans. You know, the World Bank does stability mechanisms. There's an assumption there that the environment is normally stable. And if you return it to normality, then it'll be okay. But if you look at a place like Dhaka or Lagos or Mumbai or Karachi, these places are growing so fast that they're in a dynamic disequilibrium all the time anyway. I am always reminded of JFC Fuller, who, as you guys I'm sure know, spent a bit of time in 1940 hanging around the French High Command and watching the way that they collapsed as the Germans mounted their operation in France. And he makes an observation of Gamelin's headquarters where he says that the headquarters repeatedly issued orders that would have been appropriate for a situation that had existed 24 hours before, right? So the headquarters was functioning. They were planning correctly. They were coming up with the right answer based on the information that they had, but they were continually overtaken by events because they weren't able to get there fast enough. And a lot of our thinking about, you know, the Boyd cycle and the OODA loop and so on comes from observations like Fuller's. On a different timescale, you see the same thing with city governments. The government of Dhaka has repeatedly come up with plans to deal with urban overstretch that would have been appropriate for a situation that had existed 3 or 4 years before. By the time they get it through the planning commission and they get people to agree and they make the clunky processes work, the city's already grown and developed and adapted beyond where they're at to. So I think that the idea of stabilization is something we need to let go. And we need to be focusing less on stabilization and more on resiliency. And the aid agencies that we work with in places like Syria and Afghanistan have already started to move in that direction. USAID now has a resiliency policy. I believe DFID has one too. And it's a focus on not stabilizing an environment that's inherently unstable, but teaching communities or working with communities that are in that environment and helping them to be more resilient in an unstable environment. So if stabilization is like trying to hold back the tide. Resiliency is like trying to teach people to swim. And a lot of what we've done in the work that we've done for people like the World Bank and so on in Africa has been about trying to unlock some of the adaptive resources that are already there in the community to make them more resilient. I think that that's probably the way to go. I would just end though by saying that that's akin to fire prevention, right? If you want to make a city safe from fire, fire prevention is much more important than actually fighting fires. But if you're in the fire brigade, we don't pay you to do fire prevention, we pay you to fight fires when they break out. So if you're in the military, community resilience and prevention and urban planning and all that sort of stuff, it's all good, but it's not your job, right? Our job in the military is going to be, when we get sent in, as we invariably will, into these environments, even though we all recognize that there's no military solution to these kinds of problems, we're going to have to get much more adept at operating in this very crowded, nine-domain, littoral, urban, connected environment, because that's where the people will be and that's where the conflicts will occur. And as Trotsky said, you know, you might not be interested in war, but war is interested in you. I don't see a lot of interest on the part of general staffs or political leaders or ministers of defense to come out of Afghanistan and suddenly engage in this complex, you know, urban type of conflict. People in America are hoping at some level for, you know, a break and at some level for a return to conventional type of operations. I'm sorry to say, I don't think it's coming. I think we need to be really getting our heads around this future of crowded urban coastal cities and thereby hopefully rendering all these very dire predictions that I put into my book inaccurate by getting ahead of the curve. So let me stop there. We've got a lot of stuff to talk about. Charlie, do you want to drive the questions and I'll just respond? Yeah, okay, sure. Good.
Good, excellent. David, thank you very much.